I'm Kathleen Rourke. I live in Largs on the west coast of Scotland. As a little girl, I remember the Queen's nurses in the town, and they had a big brass plaque right outside their door saying Queen's Nurse. And I didn't really quite understand what that was until, of course, I started nursing. But I do remember them. Everybody knew them. They delivered the babies and they visited the elderly. Well, there weren't many elderly, but people who were being nursed at home, because in those days, rheumatic fever, tuberculosis, a lot of these illnesses were so prevalent. When I was doing my general training, we spent one day in the community, but my day wasn't with the district nurse, it was with the factory nurse at Hoover. So I still didn't know. So it was only when I actually finished my midwifery, that I became aware of the Queen's nurses and their role in the community. I finished midwifery and I didn't know what I was going to do. And my friend who came from Ardnamurchan said to me, let's go up to the Queen's nurses and see if they've got any vacancies. So up we went. And within 2 days, I was recruited as a potential to do my district nurse training in the next course. But within days, I knew I wanted to do it. It was just such a difference. The informality of it and the sense of achievement, because it was, you were individual and not one of 28 patients. You were looking after one patient and yet you still had a whole caseload. So I really enjoyed that aspect of it. I did my district nurse training, my Queen's nurses training in Bath Street in Glasgow, 218 Bath Street. And 218 Bath Street was cut over a basement and three floors, one nursing floor and then two which were for resident, because the nurses, the Queen's nurses, the midwives, some were doing, you could do your midwifery training in the community, but you were resident, and a lot of the girls came from the islands and the north of Scotland, so they were resident. We were a classroom based but only for maybe a short time, a week or 2 weeks, and then we were allocated to very experienced district nurses who took us round. Then we were given a limited caseload, and they supervised us with this limited. I think it was maybe six patients we had, and we had to manage those six patients with them supervising us. I remember very clearly being told that, unlike a hospital where the patient was a guest, we were guests in their homes. We had to respect that. And we had to respect, however humble it was their home. And we had not to dictate. We could encourage or advise, but never to dictate. And show by example. Hand washing, courtesy, these aspects of caring, and above all, never to disclose in neighbourhoods because it would be, you might be going into three different homes in the one street, or even in the one close in a tenement, and learning to never to be discourteous, but at the same time not to disclose. So that was something you learned pretty quickly. In that sort of in home, you might have three generations. A lot of the time we had three generations, and it was dealing with each of the generations while you were in to do one dressing, you learn to cope with this, and at the same time you might be in a hurry, but you never let them know that. You had never to do that either, to look at your watch and hurry people up. In our Gladstone bags, we had very basic, we had a little kidney dish, a little bowl, and we had glass syringes and needles, which they weren't disposable, they had to be boiled up and indeed sharpened at the weekend. to make sure that you took them over a gauze swab to see if they checked them over a gauze, to see if they caught, in which case then they were sharpened, you know. So that they were, so it was, we had to boil these instruments in the patient's home. So again, it was by example showing people that, you know, you were, and washing, hand washing, making sure that these were boiled properly. And there were no such things as sterilized gauze swabs or cotton wool balls. We had to make them ourselves and bake them. So we had to, around about Christmas time, all your family members and relations who got tins of biscuits, you had your eye, they were marked on, you know, right away. Oh. And we lined those. And again, all your relatives, your aunties and grannies, linen, either pieces of linen sheets, as patients either had cotton or linen sheets, and old pillowcases, tea towels, that you could line the biscuit tin. And then we taught them to make the swabs in their own home. We'd pack them and the cotton wool balls into these biscuit tins, which were then baked in the oven at 350 degrees or something for an hour, sterilise them. So that's what we did. So that was one improvisation. The other was, you know, the medical, the cradles that we put over, the sort of cane cradles that used to go over patients' feet or to take the weight of the blanket off. Well, we didn't have access to any of those. So it was cardboard boxes. So the local fruiterer and the local, you know, the local grocers, as they were then, any boxes that were the sort of length, you know, fairly, I suppose, about 2 to 3 feet long and a couple of foot wide, or probably 2 feet wide, snaffled them, and then we cut out a window so that they could put their be put over their feet in the bed. So many things. Paper. We had no disposable sacks of any kind, so paper. The Queen's Pope. We learned to make these. And it was newspapers, and in you could then put your discarded dressings or whatever in it and dispose of them safely. The use of soup plates for the placentas, and oh, so many things we had to improvise with. sometimes even boil, sometimes it, that it was actually difficult to boil. Sometimes patients had no money, the meter had run out, you know, so you had to really be very, you know, so you tried to keep methylated spirits or something that would, you know, help in you keeping your syringe or your and no disposable scalpel blades in those days. They all got, everything got boiled out, always kept, you know, it was, 2 shilling, a florin it was, or a half a crown, and pennies, because people didn't have telephones. Very few patients had telephones. And even in quite, you know, sort of comfortable areas that you would see, you know, upmarket here, everybody didn't have a telephone because there were a limited number of actual lines that were issued. Some patients shared a line with another, either a neighbour or someone maybe they didn't know, but they were given a party line, it was called, and that was where they shared the phone. So you had to suss out where there was telephones, particularly when you were doing midwifery, where there was telephone boxes, and you kept pennies for your in your pocket. So poorly paid as we were, we would keep a wee supply of coinage in our pockets. We had a practical room in the basement where certain things were demonstrated, how to set out your surgical area if you were going to be doing dressings, preparations. Our bags were checked. They were lined. These Gladstone bags were lined with cotton lines. Everything had to be taken, stripped out on a Friday, and replaced, and the bags polished, washed and polished. Because we were, and our uniforms were made to measure in a tailor's in Glasgow, And our uniforms were very, very smart, and we were also told that that was, this was the tools of our trade, and people were going to make a judgment when they saw us. So we had at all times to be smart. Then every so often, I don't know, probably once a month, one of the superintendents came out and on the rounds with us to see how we conducted ourselves, how we carried out our practical work in the patient's home, how we dealt with them, how we dealt with other organisations such as the Red Cross, who wasn't called social work then, it was almoners, so how you conducted it, and of course how what your relationship with your the general practitioners in that area, which wasn't easy because we were geographically placed and not GP attached, so we could be dealing with maybe upwards of 30 odd doctors, and how you related to them. It wasn't advantageous actually. I would say that GP attachment was better because they got to know us and we were sharing the same patients. It could be very difficult to get hold of a doctor. So you had to often make decisions on your own because you couldn't get hold of that doctor. That some of those surgeries in those days were one doctor practices. So when he left, that was it. There wasn't an answering service like you have today. So it could be his wife that was answering the telephone, and if you'd managed to get through, and you would be running to telephone boxes, so it was difficult to relate to them. So you tended to be only relating to the ones whose patients were really ill and needing constant changing of either medication or attention of some kind. They wouldn't always agree with. You had sometimes you had to use subtlety, to sort of think, well, that's not really, this would be better. We'd get to know what to. Other times, doctors say, now come on, nurse, which, what would you use? What would you advise? And you did get that, During our training, we were allocated an area with one of these, what I would then say, clinical practice teachers or community practice teachers. We had our patients in those locations. When we finished our district nurse training and were qualified, we were then in Glasgow. We were allocated the Queen's Nursing Institute in Scotland had various houses dotted in big mansions located in all parts of the city. They tended to give you 3 months north, south, east, and west of the river, which gave you a very good window into the various population, the demography of the area. I was allocated to Ballornock and that end of sort of north of Glasgow. That was a mixture of very sort of upper middle class and very working class. So it was because it covered Springburn. So I had Ballornock looking over Springburn Park, beautiful sandstone villas, and I had Springburn, which was very, very working class and industrialised. St Rollox Works were still there. Most of the patients, the husbands or fathers, were involved working with them on these engines. Very highly skilled people. Sadly, all gone, that sort of heavy industry. Patients tended to be asthmatic, with diabetics, congestive cardiac failure, that was, heart disease was prevalent. Tuberculosis, either, pre-admission to hospital or post, where they'd maybe been in for a year and were getting home and were on the recovering. Children, a lot of children's rheumatic fever, children who had been affected by that. So it was a very mixed caseload and a mixed background. Young stroke victims, A lot of heart disease, there was no doubt about that. And of course, poverty, really real poverty. Some of it was self-inflicted poverty, bad management, bad parenting. But others, it was dire poverty through lack of work, through health reasons, because companies didn't pay. People didn't get paid for 6 months, full pay, and 6 months half pay, and all this sort of thing. They were lucky if they got paid at all for a week, even after they were ill, you know, or a lot of industrial accidents, you know, from because of heavy industry. So you got quite a lot of wound dressings and things like that. It's hard to shut off from it when you go home. Unlike in a hospital, when you've got somebody who's from a very poor background, they're being fed, they're being washed, they're warm, they're clothed. When you have a patient in a living in a home, and you have to walk out, and nobody's going to be back in there till you go back again. Because they don't fall into the category of, as today they would, being needing somebody to help them wash and, you know, once we d dealt with them, the social side, and so many of us would take something in. You would take something in, tin of soup, some homemade soup, and you know, to come home, and you're among your friends, or you're going out with your friends. And having to, you can't. Fortunately, most of my friends were nurses, so you could say without giving a name, "Oh dear, I had such and such." Sometimes they had a suggestion to make, which would be helpful. Or when you went back to base at night, we always reported every night. You might, if you were really stuck and didn't know where to go, you had, you know, somebody. There was somebody would be able to see. I think. When you went out, so you know, you would think, how can they understand what I've been through, what I've seen today? It's difficult, and people, whole communities can close their eyes to poverty in an adjoining area. There usually was an almoner or something that you could approach to get some bedding, or organizations like the St. Vincent de Paul, the Salvation Army. These were organizations who would help you out. So. They were just marvelous, you know. You could almost have a house furnished in half a day, in, you know, 4 or 5 hours. I mean, I know that was the case, and they were so highly rated among us. Again, the Salvation Army, they were just great. So they would provide food, you know, or food tokens, or these organizations that had volunteers working with them, they could understand what we were up against. But I mean, I was going home to an area which was very comfortable, and you know, nobody would have understood that sort of, and yet, you know, some of them were very proud because they hadn't, the ones that I said, they, you know, had, were there by no, you know, what's the word I want? No fault of their own, were very proud. So you had to handle that again very, very sensitively, because suddenly somebody coming in and say, and then saying, "Oh well, the St. Vincent de Paul are going to come, and they're going to get, you know." So that was you. You just learned by instinct, I think, how to deal with that sensitively. But even in cities like Glasgow, we were so well known as Queens. Oh, here's the wee nurse, or. You know, and they did, and our uniform, that was a badge of honor almost, you know. Well, we had, when we were in Glasgow, I mean, different places had slightly, but we were, uniforms were made to measure in a tailor's. Our dresses were an A-line, lovely kind of terlin material, which wore well, and you could wash it at quite high temperatures because we didn't have a laundry when we were out in the community. Our coats were serge wool, very good quality. You had about three fittings for these coats, But let me tell you, when they got wet, oh, now we had a drying room in Bath Street. Some of the houses, we had a drying room in Govan as well, because when you were out walking or cycling, and you were so, well, we all had Macs, but sometimes you were caught out, and so, I mean, you were soaking wet. You came in at lunchtime and you had to get these, change of coat. So we all had another, we had a Macintosh. It was like a Burberry, which was navy, and then our serge coats. And the Burberry's, if you knew it was wet, you could wear it. But if it was, if it was good days, it was your other. And our hats, we had, when I first joined, they were like the French Legion, but we also had the riding hats. We had epaulettes on our shoulders, which said QIDNS across our shoulders. And you had always to be smart. And underneath that, we had white cuffs. Now, what happened was, when we finished our district nurse training and qualified, we then signed a contract. We had to sign a contract with Glasgow Corporation to work with them for a year. And if you didn't fulfil that, you had to pay the corporation £5 for every month of your year's contract you didn't fulfil. I actually got an offer of a job in East Kilbride after 3 months. I could not have afforded £45. I mean, £45 was, I think we'd about £20 a month or something. That was an awful lot. I couldn't have afforded to leave and pay £45. So I had to let, but in fact, that post wasn't filled by the time I'd finished my contract and I went to work in East Kilbride. I didn't then go. But so that was what happened. And so during your year's contract, you were north, south, east and west of the river. And so that gave a very good mix of what of the sort of demography of the city. I covered all along what is now the Broomalaw. Those were hostels, Salvation Army hostels. One or two of they were like hotels, but they were working men's hostels, really. And the poverty was dire, really dire along there. And the, you know, the rats, you know, so you're constantly trying to alert the mothers to keep the baby, the prams safe, you know, because there were these backyards, and to keep the babies safe in the, you know. And of course you were giving advice on feeding and washing, cleanliness, nappies, and watching it and advising against thrush, etc. So having your own house was something that was undreamt of. So people lived in tenements and three and four up. So I'll tell you, we were fit as fiddles then, running up and down those. And then I went out to Govan, to Copeland Road in Govan. And there I was allocated a bicycle. And my area that I was given was way out Cardonald and Hillington, right on the house. So we had to cycle along Paisley Road West, Paisley Road West in all weathers. So now that was, again, very mixed. But Cardonald was very kind of, it wasn't really working class then. And then Hillington was, and there was also all the Pollock, all that. So we covered each other's days off, etc. So you'd have your own caseload and probably maybe three or four of somebody else's if it was bordering on your day. So say I had a day off and I had 12 visits that needed done. Those would be divided between the nurse on one side and the nurse on the other area. So you had a huge mix. It was a huge learning experience, but you know, you loved every, I mean, we all loved every minute of it, you know. And I think the other thing was, because we were all working, say, either in Bath Street or Govan, if you had a very sick patient, And of course, there was no Macmillan nurses then, so they were terminally ill. If you'd have a day off, somebody else would have gone. So others would understand if when that patient died or got very much worse or there was some other serious crisis arise, the others instinctively knew, and so you had great support. We didn't get counselling. None of us knew that how to spell stress or counselling. Counselling, that was for patient, that was for people who were needing a house or something, going to their local counselor. That wasn't so. I mean, we just didn't, it didn't exist, and yet we were really out in all weathers and having to make decisions. And sometimes when you'd go and see to do somebody's dressing, and you'd find that it was really, now you didn't have a phone, so you had to think, right, I've got, so very often you would do a temporary bit, run down to the local chemist, because your local chemists were wonderful, all of the, you, they were so helpful and so, and sort of say, look, I can't get a prescription for this yet. Can I, can you give me such and such? For instance, there was one called Usol, and this was, we used to pack wounds with that to heal them from the inside out. And it was called, Usol was actually Edinburgh University solution of lime. And you would pack wounds or with that or, dressings, if you got cellulitis and things, so you'd have to think, oh, I've got to, or you'd go in and a patient who was on an injections, drugs, and they would have had a reaction. You would have to stop, you'd decide, I better stop this, and then find a doc, find the doctor to say, look, I've stopped it, but the patient needs something else. Those kind of decisions, or sometimes you went in and somebody's condition had deteriorated so much, you would have to say, look, we've got to get this patient to hospital, and do it yourself. You couldn't get to, you didn't, hadn't a phone. Maybe you could get a neighbour. There might be a neighbour with a phone, or a neighbour who would go for a phone, so, and you would just phone the ambulance service, Yes, well, I suppose looking back on it, it was brave and courageous, but we didn't think about it. I would say I there are some people who are not perhaps cut out. I have seen people who haven't been cut out for community nursing. A good Queen's nurse, I believe, should first of all, be caring and compassionate. I think they. I also believe that they need to be very sensitive to the patients because they are in a different environment. They're having to have someone come into their home to help them, and sometimes that's difficult for patients. They're very independent in their role. So a good Queen's nurse has to recognise these things, these aspects of patients and their care. They've also, I believe, to be able to adapt to accepting that maybe what they would like to do is not what the patient wants to do and wants to have done. And so they've to accept that there comes a time when you have to accept. There are times when you have to over try to overrule them in the best way possible. But it's again, it's being sensitive to these areas. A good Queen's nurse needs to be feisty because they are dealing with, well, first of all, the situation, it could be a difficult one. So they've to really fight the corner. Or it could be somebody who needs a lot of help and finding that help for them. And they've got to find, the patient's not fit to do it. The Queen's nurse has to be able to fight the corner for that patient and getting good. It might be equipment for, I've had to do that, fight to get a special bed because there's no way this patient could be nursed at home without it. So they really do need to be feisty. After I completed my year's contract in Glasgow as a Queen's nurse, I then moved out to East Kilbride, and it was a very different experience because East Kilbride at that time, I think there was 50,000 of a population, very no unemployment, very good housing, but there was only two of us, and it was border outlying farms, so there was only a little village centre. So there was, the problems were slightly different there. People were leaving their families, a lot from Glasgow, it was overspill. People were leaving friends and families, roots that they'd had, and there was no granny, mammy, auntie around to help out. So the loneliness was very prevalent, and the fact that, again, even although it was a very sort of privileged community, it was bordered by farms. There was a lot of farm workers who were very poorly paid, very poorly housed, very insecure in their employment. And so, you know, what should have been a relatively easy job became quite difficult because, again, we were having to involve organisations to support families because they'd know where to go and they didn't know people, you know. So it was, and there was a great, I would say as a Queen's, it was a great opportunity to approach because the ministers, the clergy, because churches were having to provide entertainment, if you like, you know, because there was no cinemas, there was no, so there was a great collaboration among professionals, you know, GPs, because they recognised this among their patients, the teachers in the schools, because the children, there was no, you know, there were no playgroups, no, it was such a new community. But it was a great sense of collaboration. And, I mean, the shops were wonderful, the pharmacy, the, you know, the grocer, they were so good, you know, when things were short, you say, oh, you know, I've got X number, sugar was short, salt was short, you know, bread was, things, you know, for various reasons of industrial action. And, you know, they were great and they would help us out. I mean, it was, but we were 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. I was there for 3.5 years, but I met my husband just before I moved to East Kilbride. And I got married when I was there. And then I moved, my husband was then moved to Hampshire, to Southampton. And I moved then to Hampshire with him and my two children. And at first I didn't, there was no way of working because I had no support whatsoever and he was away a great deal. And so I actually, I'm not a sort of coffee morning person. I don't mind coffee morning to raise funds for something, but I couldn't just go along and sit in a neighbour's house for 2 hours. That's just not me. So I had noticed a little freebie newspaper and that we got, and there was an advert in it for hospital volunteers. And I thought, oh, I could do that. So I could do flowers or I could read to patients or I could, you know, look after the plants or something. So I phoned up, got an application form, and this application form, I filled it in, sent it back, and within less than 36 hours, I had a phone call from the matron of the general hospital, because the volunteer coordinator had received this and immediately saw that I was a trained district nurse and a theatre sister, had previously been a theatre sister. So this was her calling me. And in the mid-60s, getting to around about 1967-68, because a whole generation of us had left the profession, so we were getting called back into it. I was back in hospital then for about 7 years, and then by stroke of luck, I was I was a night sister in a hospital in Southampton, the Royal Southants, and I was in theatres, but if I didn't have cases, I helped out on the wards with the students, because we had student nurses on all wards who were supervised, and I liked to help out. We'd had someone break into our lockers and steal our different people lost different items of uniform. Somebody lost a belt, somebody lost a dress, somebody a hat. Of all things, they took my badge, which was my general. So to secure my apron, I had my Queen's badge on. And I happened to do a ward round with a student in one of the surgical wards, and there had been a new admission that day who turned out to be the superintendent of district nursing in Southampton. And the first thing, they didn't tell me that, they just said, this gave me this woman's name, and she looked at me and said, why are you wearing that badge? What are you doing in here wearing that badge? So I said, oh, it's my Queen's Nurse's badge, very proudly, because... She said, yes, well, you shouldn't be in here. So I said, I couldn't do district nursing. I said, because I've got two young children, I'm only part-time. And of course, you know, I couldn't, and my husband's away a lot. Oh, she said. I said, so between covering nights and et cetera, et cetera. Oh, she said, we've got a night nursing service and we've got an evening service. And so I said, oh, how interesting. Anyway, about maybe 3-4 months later, a phone call, and it was this person to say, could I come in and talk to her? And that launched me back into the community, and there I stayed for many years, going from different places at different grades. You know, I was promoted in each of the places. I did my practical work teacher course at our clinical practice in King Alfred's teacher training college in Winchester. So I worked in the community in Southampton. I then became a nursing officer there. And then my husband's move took me up to live in Berkshire, but I got a job in Surrey, which was in charge of a community hospital to merge communities and local hospital together. And that was covering four. So that was a very enjoyable time in my life. And then my husband was posted back to Glasgow. So I came and I applied for the post. I just happened to see in Nursing Times was for an assistant director. I was by this time assistant director in Surrey. And I saw this for an assistant director in Inverclyde. So I thought, oh, I'll send off for that. And it was Argyll and Clyde, I should say. And I sent off, and as it came back as the director's post. And so I was interviewed and I came back, and that's why I became the director of nursing for Inverclyde Community Health Services, which was district nursing, health visiting, Macmillan, you know, all the services. It involved managing district nurses, health visitors, school nurses, Macmillan nurses, Marie Curie services, and of course being responsible for the delivery of, through my staff, of home nursing and in health visiting, the cervical screening, diphtheria vaccination programs, and then the throughput to the schools, where it continued with this through the school nurses, with practice nurses and outpatient in each of the health centres. We'd x-ray all the backup facilities, so it was ensuring that all the care was delivered at all aspects. Particularly when I was on the management team, where finances and resources were being decided, there had not been a community voice on those teams and on these management teams before, absolutely not. And so we were the first, I was the first, there was other two colleagues in Argyll and Clyde and Glasgow, where we were for the first time having a voice on these management teams that covered major teaching hospitals, general hospitals. And we were able to influence in that, for instance, discharging early. Now, there had been a huge success story in cancer of the esophagus, etc., laryngeal cancer. They were being able to, where before these patients died, they were being able to discharge these, but they were discharging them, and we didn't have the equipment. We had to say, there's no way we can, you must get the, give us the resources to be able to buy this equipment, because they couldn't come home. They could, are going to have to stay in hospital. So we, because we had the knowledge of, and had the, I was experienced, and again, when they were looking at targets for what they were, the term was being used as contacts. Now, a contact with a patient could be, I mean, it was ridiculous. There was something, oh, a visit should be 20 minutes. You go into somebody who's just been diagnosed and terminally ill, how can you do a visit in 20 minutes? You have to sit, you have to get, you have to make contact with the patient. You've never met this patient before. So we had to, you know, and the other thing was that they were saying, oh, there's only X number of visits. We said, hang on a minute, that's a patient who has got skin, very severe eczema. It takes two nurses 1 hour to deal with all these. Patient with lots of patients, because the west of Scotland particularly, although Scotland in general, has a very high incidence of multiple sclerosis. You're dealing with young people whose condition is getting worse, mums with children and the MS, and saying to management team people, we need more, you know, more money needs to be allocated to support these people at home. So having a community background, whereas before, patients just chucked out and no account taken of what they needed at home, no home assessment, no nothing. But I wore that with the great pride. Well, I would say my training as a Queen's nurse was pivotal to everything that I, because I learned to be, I suppose care and compassion is inherent, but being able to develop a sensitivity to people's needs, never mind patients, because sometimes it's not just the patient, it's their families, and understanding what help they need, and, you know, that's what I do believe. Plus, the teaching by example. I think that was, in spite of having been done a clinical practice teacher, and also with the English National Board when I did assessments of students, but being, you know, able to teach by example in everything you do, how you conduct yourself, how you represent, you know, how you introduce yourself, how you and it doesn't need to be stilted. And I think that was the other thing I learned, was that patients love to hear your, what you've been doing. They love to hear about your family, you know, particularly if you're long term, you know, a long term patient, what their children are doing, what your husband's been doing, what you've been doing. They love, because you're coming in and it's a new, they're restricted, often they're not able to get out. So this, you know, they love to hear all this. And leadership skills doesn't just mean a leadership of a whole. It can mean leading a family into dealing with problems that as a result of patient's illness. Mm-hmm. Very proud of being a Queen's nurse. It's almost like your heart, you know. I was always very proud of it. The principles of the community nursing under the Queen's Nursing Institute, and all that it's the ethos of the care that they it's so sad that it was lost, and it has to come back, because more and more people are going to need more and more care. More than ever, there's a role for the Queen's nurses to be at the sharp end of community care, looking after patients in their own home and their families to support them, as more and more elderly and their families are away, they're not local, work has taken them away, they need help, and the Queen's nurse is pivotal to that care.